and welcome to Round Ball Rules. Yes, it is a Thursday, but better late than never. It's a special finals edition episode of the show. And with me, Simon Hill.
Welcome, good to see you, Robbie.
80-time capped Socceroo and former captain, of course, Mark Milligan.
Afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone. So we're going to have a look back at what has been a very busy week of finals football. We had two elimination finals, two semi-final first legs as well. There was plenty to talk about, and I hope you gentlemen are ready to deliver some finals football analysis.
Like coiled springs we are, aren't we, Milsey?
No sideways passes, okay? Just going for it, straight through. Two-footed, off the ground, through balls every time. So we're going to start with the opening elimination final, which was back on Saturday. It was in Melbourne. It was the Western United side taking on Wellington Phoenix. And it ended 1-0, goal in the 10th minute from Prijovic. There you see it. Fine finish. Yeah, beautiful finish. And his quality showing through, because we knew he was a proven goal scorer when he arrived here. Took him a little while to hit his stride. And after that, it was the goalkeeper's show, wasn't it?
Well, first of all, on Prijovic, I think he's had a terrific, particularly second half of the season. You know, obviously it took him a little while to find his feet, but in the second half, it was really all about Jamie Young. And I think he, Birigis, this save is unbelievable. This is reminiscent of Gordon Banks for England, 1970 against Brazil, where Pelé was almost celebrating the goal before he poured it away.
And he did shout goal, didn't he?
Yeah.
Pelé,
and I think that was very similar. It's an incredible save. What, I think that's save of the season beyond question.
Yeah, it's unbelievable. I think both keepers made some decent saves, but Jamie Young, as you see them on their own as well, I think they become even more meaningful. And like you said, that save there is, I think, save of the season. I remember seeing it as it was happening, and you're nearly going to get a drink because you think there's going to be a goals break. So it's fantastic.
Ufuk Tale said that he was the man of the match. Let's have a listen to the outgoing coach, eliminated Ufuk Tale.
Yeah, look, disappointed that we lost the game. I think Jamie Young was probably the best player on the park. And I think that tells you a bit of a tale about the game. I think we created enough chances to get ourselves back in the game. But disappointed at the end that we don't continue. But look, very, very proud of the group. Show their resilience and perseverance to get to where we got to this season.
Simon, a quick word on Wellington Phoenix. We know it was a tough season for them. We've spoken about a lot. Everyone's spoken about a lot. Do you think that was a fair result, though, for them? Or they could have got more? Piscopo's shot was a brilliant moment as well, and we know that he was an important player for them.
Look, they certainly knocked on the door in the second half. There's no doubt about that. They didn't, you know, die wandering, but unfortunately they came up against a goalkeeper that's in, you know, very good form. It was a rather typical Western United performance in many ways. You know, they invite pressure. They play on the counter to a large degree. And it's credit to Wellington that they got so many efforts on goal in against a team that defends so well. But I think overall, as Uffy says, they can be proud of their season. Given the obstacles that have been put against them, the only other club really that's comparable in terms of the difficulties that has been faced is Perth. And look where they finished. Yeah. So, you know, that's a testament to what Wellington did this season. To make the finals is, you know, that's a big tick for them. And next season when they're back on their home deck in New Zealand, then, you know, they can hope to push on, providing they can keep Uffy.
Well, I think Uffy's done a fantastic job. I know we've touched on it a few times, but what he's had to go through with that team over the last couple of seasons is unheard of in football, really. And what he's been able to do and achieve is fantastic. While he'll be disappointed that they did go out because their performance was, you know, was good good enough to continue, they're just not their day. What he's done through all the travel and having people away from their families and has been fantastic.
And it's just a slight disappointment, just a final point on this, that we don't get to see a home final in Wellington, because I reckon they'd have packed the joint out, which would have been fantastic. But anyway, there we go.
I think this match just highlighted, once you reach the finals, you believe that you can go all the way. And they've all been tight. Every single match we've had so far has been tight, starting with that one. Next up, and this was tight as well, even though the score doesn't necessarily reflect it, Adelaide at home against another young side, another side with plenty of kids out on the pitch in the Central Coast Mariners. It ended up 3-1 for the Reds, and it all started with that Craig Goodwin goal. Gentlemen, what did you make of this one?
The first goal, I think, maybe a little lucky in terms of...
Certainly, it wasn't an intended pass.
I don't think that ball was intended to go inside there. But again, Craig Goodwin with a fantastic finish. You know, he still had quite a bit of work to do. Birigetti's had a fine season. Now, you wouldn't back against him to save that. But look, Adelaide at home and the run coming into the finals, as the Mariners have had, has been excellent. So I think at home, that home support as well, and late on in the game, I think that's what really gets them across the line.
And that third goal, Bernardo, yet again, a goal off the bench for Carl Beers. He's used his subs so well this season, and those young kids in particular. This time it was Bernardo, before it's been Mo Torre, before that it's been Nestoria and Kunda. They've really given him a different option off the bench, and that's why they've had so many late comebacks.
Now, there was one very controversial moment in the second half, and I'm going to go first to Millsy, the coach, about this one, to see how a coach would have reacted necessarily, or perhaps what's actually going on the sideline. But it's the moment where Lewis Miller is injured and walking off the field. The substitutions, both sides are ready to make double substitutions. Lewis Miller comes to the sideline with the doctor, and at that moment, as he crosses the field, the Mariners are down to 10 men. Joe Gauci takes a quick kick, and from one touch, cross in, goal, while the Mariners are at 10 men. And Nick Montgomery was just saying, but we were making a substitution. The game was stopped, we were down to 10 men, and they attacked the exact position on the field where Lewis Miller wasn't, where the Mariners were without a right back. How did you see it, Millsy?
There's probably a couple things to it. And obviously, I know it's been mentioned that perhaps that sub wasn't the intended sub. So Lewis Miller wasn't intended to be the one that came off. So there had to be a little bit of tinkering in how the system was going to look once their sub was made. You know, obviously, they've said, or I've heard, that the subs weren't really ready to come on. So that might have been that. I can see that from both sides as well. Maybe a tactic from the Mariners as well, knowing that they're going to be a man down, just getting someone, get up there, make sure you're ready to go on, or appear to be ready to go on, so that we can make this substitution. And well, the other thing to it is as well, if you lose a defender, generally the first thing you'll do is slide a midfielder in to fill that space. So, you know, it's a little bit.
Yeah, they should have adapted, they should have reacted
on both
quickly.
Sides. So, yeah, I understand the answer.
It was 1-0 at the time as well. So, I mean, this was that crucial second goal which changes
this.
The game.
There's only three people who know the truth here. One is Nick Montgomery. Yeah. Two is the fourth official. And three is the
Ali referee. Alireza Fagani, fourth official in this one.
So the communication is either broken down somewhere or somebody's telling porcupines. Who it is, I don't know. I can perfectly understand why Nick Montgomery is furious about it, because his team concedes a goal when they're down to 10 men, and in his opinion, needlessly so, because they had a sub ready to come on. If that's the case, then it's an official error, an error by the officials. It's unfortunate, because you don't want to see finals games, not that it probably was decided by that, but you don't want to see big moments like that happen in finals.
How far did he came off at halfway? So he's obviously had a way to travel.
Yeah.
So for me, whether the sub's made or not, you still have time to adjust your formation on the field to cover the area that's being left by the
injured player. You're not doing that. If you're thinking, well, I'm sending on Storm Roux because he's going to take Lewis Miller's position. So if you're just waiting to make that sub, you're not also going, just in case we're not allowed to make the sub, but I'll have to tinker with my team tactically.
Yeah, so that tells the thing from both sides. But as a player on the field, as someone in that moment, you'd want that spot, because you don't know if a sub's coming on or not. So I'm saying someone needs to take responsibility.
But if you can see him on the sideline, I'm sure. And you know, the coach is there ready to make a sub. You're expecting him to come on, aren't you?
I never saw half the time when subs were made, I didn't know they were made when I was playing.
So you just fill into that position.
So if someone went down, you'd fill that spot.
Yeah. Okay. Well, anyway, let's not leave the Mariners on a negative note. They too had a great season after last year, where they rose from the ashes, if you like, under Alan Stajic. This time, a good campaign, particularly with that final run of finishing with that series of fantastic results to get them into the finals. They came from a long way back. They have a bunch of kids, and the future looks bright. There's Richard Peel, the new man who's coming in at the helm, taking over from Charlesworth. So is this a sea change for the Mariners? Are we looking at a bright new future all of a sudden?
Well, I think that change started last year, as you rightly said, under Alan Stajic. I mean, before that, the Mariners were in the doldrums for years, weren't they? But all of a sudden, they've had this reinvention, if you like, and a lot of it is through the kids. And that was what the Mariners always were back in the day. You know, bringing through players like Matty Ryan, like Trent Sainsbury, like Bernie Abini, and then selling them on for decent money overseas. And they've sort of got back to that. And I think that's good. Yeah. You know, that's sort of their identity. It's what they should be. It's what a lot of A-League clubs should be. So I think that's now back in their DNA. Nick Montgomery has taken it on to the next level from Alan Stajic. I think he's done a terrific job this season, even though they finished a little bit further down on the ladder. I think next season there's no reason, you know, providing they can keep the nucleus of that squad together, there's no reason why they can't kick on even further.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say about Montgomery this season. So, yes, of course, last year was excellent what they were able to do and what Stajic did to the Mariners turn around. I think Monty took it a step further because I think the football that they played this year was a more enjoyable brand. Like I say, speaking from personal, you know, they were very effective last year, but I think the football that he had them playing this year was excellent to watch as well as effective.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay, now the other chat I had proposed for this segment was knocked out by the producers, but I have another one. We've seen this question of possession, playing with the ball, playing without the ball. Was there a hint in this first game, Western United versus Wellington, a little bit in the second one, and we'll get to it in the semi-finals as well, of here, have the ball, because when you have two sides that want to counter-attack, we saw Wellington finish with nearly two-thirds of possession, were unable to do anything with it. In the second elimination final, or in fact in the first semi-final as well, where we had Melbourne victory against Western United, the battle to lose the ball, where do you guys stand on that in terms of a side dominating in play or one counter-attacking, Millsy first?
Now, I think it's more what you're set up to do. So I don't think there is a wrong or right whether you want to be a counter-attacking team, whether you want to sit in, and it comes back to your formation argument as well. Mm-hmm. If you're a 4-4-2 that want to hit channels and you train that way and you play that way, no problem. So when you come up against the two teams that are counter-attacking teams, someone has to take the initiative. Yeah, someone has to then go against the way that they do things on a day-to-day basis. I think you saw that Western were very aware of that against Victory, because that first 20 minutes they tried to push on and it was a little bit unnatural to them. They need something to defend. So when you go away from what you do on a day-to-day basis, I think it becomes a little bit more difficult. So when you have to, if you're a defensive team, and then you have to take the game to someone. And with two legs, I think you're seeing it again now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's tough. So if you have possession, it's hard to switch that change that switch to all of a sudden be an aggressive team.
Yeah.
You know, when you're very, very effective at sitting in and hitting teams on the counter, to then say, you know what, be proactive, keep the ball, go forward. It's very, very difficult just to change that mindset.
I think we make too much of possession. And I think it all stems probably from, you know, the change in the curriculum to go to the Dutch system, which is based around the 1-4-3-3 and keeping possession of the ball and rotations and all that sort of stuff. And we still see a lot of teams in the A-League play that way. So we're very focused on possession numbers. Oh, they've had 60% of the ball. They've had 67% of the ball. Yeah. Does it matter? You can
well, string clearly together doesn't, seeing the results 30 we've seen or 40 in passes, some of these finals.
But if it's inside your own half of the field, then it's meaningless.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, Western United have based largely that entire season around letting the opposition have the ball.
Yeah.
You know, they rarely dominate with the ball, but they're very effective at winning matches because they've got, you know, good experienced players that can impact in the attacking third. So it's like Millsy says, it's about playing to your strengths as a team. And I think we've got to essentially move away from this obsession with saying, oh, we should have won because we had 68% of the ball. It only matters if you're actually raining shots on goal down the opposition. And too many A-League teams can't do that, despite that huge weight of possession.
Well, just before you jump in, Millsy, I have a theory that basically it's harder to win consistently if you're dominating possession, or you have to be very, very good at it. We know that there are coaches that love to have possession and try and dominate and get their players, like you say, to be positive and proactive. But really, it's much easier to just sit back and try and counterattack and put an extra couple of people in defence, have a defensive mindset, than it is to be proactive and try and dominate
game,
football
it's
matches.
It's also the modern game, Mills, isn't it? The modern game
look at
is transition.
Side. Absolutely.
It's transition.
It's space. It's controlling space without the ball and then affecting space with the ball.
Yeah.
So you think the teams that I don't necessarily love a team that will just sit off and hit you on the counter, but they're controlling space, so they're controlling the game when they do it well without the ball. Mm-hmm. and then they're exposing the space when they do have it. So I think that's modern football is, yes, maybe not so much just transition, but how you best control space. And when you talk possession, I think there's only really been one team for me, probably in A-League history.
Brisbane Roar.
Yeah, but that was effective possession yeah. because it would always be in the opposition's front third or half, and you could see they did it on a daily basis. Mm. Yeah, so if you just you can't just go to a team and say, right, this, today I want you to keep possession. Because you'll find they'll go sideways, sideways, backwards, backwards, end up in their own third, yeah. own half. Then they're not controlling any space with or without the ball. Mm. If you train it and play it and have it in the right areas, then I think it's still relative.
Okay, moving along. To the So that's at the end of the eliminations. Mariners are out, Phoenix are out. Our Western United side and Adelaide have to back up immediately because of this new finals format.
You're not a fan of the finals format, Robbie.
This is for later. This is a second argument that will... No, I am. I am a traditionalist in when it comes to many football rules and elements. And that was a little bit tongue-in-cheek, our pre-show chat
about the
two-legged final. No, we will get to it. The benefits or otherwise of playing home and away in the semi-finals as opposed to just a one-off winner-takes-all. Because we did see, and we're going to talk about them right now, two a little bit cagey first leg semi-finals. Understandable considering that there was no place in the grand final on offer on Tuesday or Wednesday night. That's going to be decided at the end of 180, perhaps a little bit more minutes. First up, we had Western United then backing up at Amy Park at home to Melbourne Victory. And there was this inside the first 5 minutes, the big talking point as it turns out, because after that talking point, there was this, which has gotten a little bit lost, I feel, in the narrative.
Oh, I don't know about that.
That's a stunning goal.
A lot of headlines.
Yeah.
That was a terrific finish from Joe Brewer, who's had a super season. And obviously, Victory now in the ascendancy. However, and Millsy, I think we all agree, should have been a penalty, shouldn't it?
The more I see it, the more I think it's a pen.
Yeah.
And then we hear the explanation behind it, and then the more I think it's a pen.
Robbie's got the explanation.
I do have the explanation. So we wanted to add a little bit more to this debate than just, we think it's a pen, what happened, how did the referees miss that, what's the point of VAR, et cetera, et cetera. So the referees obviously go through a process when every incident happens on the field. There is conversation, there is communication between the central referee and the fourth official. So basically, this is the word out of the referee's camp. Lockie Wales gained front position in the contest, and after doing so, he then stopped his forward movement. Davidson could not prevent his forward momentum, and therefore contact was unavoidable. So that's how the referees saw this incident. Then the role of VAR, basically VAR had a look. They automatically commence an immediate check of incident using all camera angles. The referee, who had a clear view of the incident, described it to VAR as per above. So Lockie Wales had front position, stopped, initiated the contact, if you like, provoked the contact with Jason Davidson. VAR saw it the same way, had nothing to add to that, so no clear, because it would just come down to referee's interpretation if he was to go across and have a look at the TV screen anyway. So in terms of the referees, that's how they saw it, that's how they adjudicated, that's how they made their decision. Who wants to go first?
Millsy, because you've got a point about Lockie Wales stopping.
Well, I've got 2 points about Lockie Wales stopping. The first one is he works hard to gain front position because he's an attacker, he wants to cross the ball and he wants to score. Yeah? He's coming up to the byline, the ball's bouncing. Okay, so he's had to slow down. Otherwise, he runs past the ball, which is
no good to
anyone.
The ball is dropping and bouncing. Yeah.
Exactly. So if he continues at the same pace as he used to get to the ball, he will see here. So if he keeps up that pace, he runs past the ball. If he wants to cross, he has to stay with the ball there. If he wants to cross, he can't cross the ball facing the sideline, so he has to slow to adjust his body to get the ball into the box. Jason Davidson tries to get around to the byline there for me because he wants to clear it. Lockie Wales can't go anywhere. He wants to score. He gains front position because he wants the ball, he wants to cross. Two reasons he needs to slow down. And that's why I think if he goes over and looks at the VAR, he will see the ball position in relation to Lockie Wales and understand that he doesn't initiate contact because he wants a foul. He initiates contact because he wants to get the ball under control.
That was the third point I was going to add to that, is if you look at that side camera angle, you see that when the ball bounces up, it almost stops a little bit.
Yes.
So it doesn't bounce on truly in forward momentum fashion. It actually goes a little bit straighter up in the air, which is why he has to sort of check his run, and then Davidson collides.
That's what I mean. Otherwise, he ends up in the front row, yeah. So he has to stay with the ball.
Yeah. I think it's a penalty.
There's no arms involved from Davidson, which I think is also something that comes into that, your first perception of it when you see it for the first time. It's putting pressure on or whatever. It's not going in with the old push.
No, it's clumsy.
It's clumsy. Exactly. And I think that was said in the commentary as well. But one thing, and I think we've all had this reflection afterwards, is that if it's a defender who's trying to shield the ball out of play and the forward comes in and just pushes him over like you see a million mm-hmm. times, it's a free kick.
We had the same thing in the Adelaide Melbourne City game on Wednesday night.
Yeah.
Ryan Kitto barging into the back of Carl Jenkinson. Peep, free kick.
Yeah, but is there a difference then? Should there be a difference in the force used or the quality of the foul, if you like, between a free kick and a penalty? A penalty is a big deal. We know that Western United, when they go up 1-0...
I'm not sure that's in the rule book, though, is it? Robert?
It's not in the rule book, but does it play? And do we as fans and do we as observers accept that a penalty has to be a little bit more? I've watched games with Millsy saying, there's not enough in that. That's not enough.
Yeah, but that, like, he's not gone down softly. He's not He's not dragged a leg looking for the contact.
Yeah. Okay.
He's legitimately trying to bring the ball under control.
Yeah. I think what amplifies this, unfortunately, I've said this a million times over lots of other incidents, because we now have VAR, when we have an incident like that, we expect it to at least be reviewed.
But that's what I mean.
But the fans in the stadium,
but they are reviewed.
They want to see the ref be asked to come and have a look at it on the sideline, because that is now the expectation.
But that's just going to slow the game down again.
Of course.
But that's when, we don't want to keep slowing the game down.
No, we don't.
I think, and we do appreciate the referees at least sending us their version of events here. That's very important, that the referees don't just be silent thing that nobody understands. So we thank them for sending us their interpretation of what happened.
It'd be even better if we could actually hear them during the call.
Well, you can occasionally, yeah. Get
The stadium for the fans.
Yes, exactly. Oh, in the stadium. Have you ever heard a tannoy try and explain something on inside a stadium?
You wouldn't understand anything. It's IFAB, isn't it, that won't allow it? So I know that, I think the APL would like that. I think they would love to hear that conversation between the VAR and the referee.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, at the moment, IFAB don't allow it. Maybe they will next season. Who knows?
But they are all being recorded as well. The other thing to take away from it before we move on is that all situations during a match are looked at by the VAR.
Of course.
They are looking at everything the whole time. So it's not things don't go unseen. It's just, again, I think what you come down to is the way this is being used, the way it's being utilised, that it has to be
and the way
clearer
it's being
and more transparent.
To the fans.
Exactly.
Yeah. But mind you, I don't think even if that was a pen, that changed the outcome or the result of the game.
No.
Yeah. Okay. Good point. Even though the outcome will be this weekend. Anyway.
Yeah, of that game.
Yeah, that game. Then just one word, please. Give me some joy on Jake Bremer's goal. Millsy.
Yeah.
Superb.
Fantastic.
And worthy of winning a match of football like that.
100%. The way that it hits it, it's a very, very difficult technique. Yeah. It's falling. You see how he hits it with no spin, which then gives it the dip into the things that I could only dream of as a player.
Mm. But I like Bremer as a player. I think he's
unbelievable.
Terrific. He's
but no control better better. Either. Just, yeah. Okay, we move on. Well done, Jake Bremer. Next, Adelaide versus Melbourne City then. So this was the return to action of Melbourne City after a difficult end to the season. They just got across the line against Wellington to ensure the Premier's plate. There was a lot of expectation about what we'd get, Simon. You called this one. How did you see this one against an in-form Adelaide?
Well, to be honest, I think both teams can take plenty out of this game. Melbourne City probably should have won it on chances created. Jamie McLaren missed a couple of really good ones, which normally you would score. Yeah, there was another controversial call, potentially. Was it a handball against Jenkinson? We'll come to that. In terms of Adelaide United, I thought their performance was decent, given that they only had 3 days to get ready for it. I don't think they'll be too disappointed by the fact that they didn't take a lead. Obviously, they would have preferred it, but they've won already once this season at Amy Park. Mm-hmm. They know that they're capable of going down there and winning if they're on form. And crucially, they'll have that extra, 2 or 3 days recovery to really get the lactic acid out of their legs and and give it a good go at the weekend. So I think, you know, it's really evenly poised, that one.
Yeah, and
sounds obvious, that, doesn't it? Because it's 0-0.
No, it is. And I dare say you'll see a few changes from probably, especially Adelaide, because Yangi coming back off injury, who, since he's been back, has been excellent.
Couldn't back up too much straight away. Yeah.
But then you also look at Jakobsen and things like that as well, who was out for quite a while injured. He's had to back up, so will he be able to? I thought Popovic was excellent. And obviously Bernardo is pushing, I think, for a starting spot. We know City probably won't make too many changes because generally they don't. Whether that's in the starting lineup or off the bench as well. Adelaide have won in Melbourne this year.
Yep. City had a charter flight to get back last night, which was... that shows perhaps the difference between the haves and the have-nots. So it gives them the best, you know, possible recuperation time for that second leg. Mm. And I was just going to make a point
for
on
me,
that.
For me, that makes a big difference. Getting back in the night, travelling in comfort amongst yourselves.
Sleep in your own bed.
Heading back, getting home, absolutely. Big difference, big advantage.
The two-legged format as well, by the way. I know you don't, Robbie, but I'm a fan of it. I think it was great last night. The three stands that were open at Cooper's were all pretty much full. Mm-hmm. So they had a second home final to enjoy, even though it was midweek, and they all turned up. A bit more money in the coffers. And I think it's a good football contest over two legs. I think it makes it interesting. I'd just prefer to still have away goals.
Well, that's gone. Finished. I know away goals. My feeling with this finals format, and look, I don't have a big problem with the finals format either. I would prefer to see two real home and away. Obviously, that's affected by the fact that we have three of these four semi-finals being played at Amy, the two legs of Melbourne Victory versus Western United. Why not play home and away in the cup, where you can see that difference? Because for me, at this stage, we're playing... Sides were cagey in that first leg. This is finals football. This is where it's on the line. It's not home and away over the course of a season, which is what we've already seen. All sides play home and away over the course of the league to get across the line. This is a different beast, so keep it a different beast. Finals football, 90 minutes, go, extra time, penalties, sudden death.
What do you think?
Throw it all out there.
I think he makes an excellent argument.
I just like having more football.
No, absolutely. But it is great that Adelaide have this final and then that there'll be the return leg. But for me, that's pure cup competition. And if we're going to have this thing that's finals, which doesn't exist anywhere else, we're not going to play best of seven like in America, in the NBA or anything. So they don't have a finals. I think in NFL, you don't have home and away, do you? In an NFL playoff.
No idea.
Neither do I. I assume it's just a... Okay. We won't be bringing North American sports into this anymore. One last point on this match, which does work very well over two legs, is that there was a little bit of niggle, particularly in this game, this last match. Here we see it here. A couple of hits off the ball, words exchanged. No surprise who was at the centre of so much of it on so many occasions. But, what did you gents make of this? And how exciting is this, looking forward to the return leg
Milton,
at Amy now?
You and I were talking about this incident here where Michael Jakobsen taps Matt Leckie on the head and then really sort of invites that shirt front confrontation. And I thought that was just two old guys, experienced guys going at it. But you were saying to me after, and Danny McBreen made the point during the call, that Michael Jakobsen is thinking instinctively, Leckie's on a yellow card. If I rile him up here, maybe he gets a second yellow and he's out of the second leg.
I think so. And I think he's probably, you know, one of the only players that, you know, would have experienced these two-legged sort of games and, you know, what's involved in getting across the line in them as well. Because you see when the tackle happens, he walks off to the ball and then there's like a moment. He turns around and he comes back. Mm. So I think he has. I think he's had a little...
He's a little light bulb moment.
Yeah, I think he's had a little nibble. And like I say, if it's anyone else, maybe, he's just a little bit frustrated. But I think he's looking for that reaction for Lex. But, you know, credit to Lex. He didn't step across that line. He didn't take it too far. So his experience came into play as
absolutely.
Well. And that was the same with all the incidents through the night. So, yes, there was that niggle and that little bit of fire, a little bit of passion. But no one took it, you know, too far, which was important for both teams.
Mm. I enjoyed it. I thought it was a great game.
Yeah, it was. Well, I think all the games have been great so far. So we're blessed with this two-legged semi-final format, which we love, to qualify for the grand final. That's it for this first half of the show. We're going to be back in the second half to look ahead to the return legs this weekend. And we'll even chat a little bit of A-League All-Stars versus FC Barcelona as well. Welcome back to this finals edition of Round Ball Rules. We've looked at what is past. Now let's have a look at what is to come, starting this Saturday down in Melbourne. Melbourne Victory taking on Western United. 4:30 coverage starts on 10 Bold and Paramount Plus. Kickoff at 5 p.m. It's an early kickoff because of the national election, which will take place on Saturday night. But most important for Western United fans and Melbourne Victory fans, of course, is what happens at Amy Park. Simon, first up, Melbourne Victory, 6 games without defeat.
At home,
16 without defeat, of course. It's a club record. Yeah. They're getting closer to Sydney's club record. And then after that, Brisbane, who we mentioned earlier, way out in front. What are you expecting from this one? Surely Victory start favourites after that first leg.
Yeah, look, I think so. And I mean, they had the majority of fans in the stands, obviously, in leg one. They certainly will in leg two. I can't see them not scoring. And that means that, you know, Western are going to have to score at least twice, which they don't do too often. So I think it's victories to lose. They did the hard work in the first leg. They weren't necessarily at their best, but they've got goals in them. Not just from Jake Brimley, who scored this beauty that we talked about already, but Rojas, D'Agostino, you know, Marjota, Volupele off the bench, if required, Fellaini. I think Victory are going to go through. But, you know, obviously it's not beyond the realms of possibility. I could be wrong, but I think it'll be Victory.
Yeah, I think Victory go through as well. But one thing that may sit in Western's favour is I can't see Victory going into this game and just defending the lead that they already have. They're going to play their normal game. They're going to try and get out and they're going to try and score goals. So for Western United, that will leave openings at times. They're just going to have to be extremely clinical when they do get those half chances or the chances. That's the only way I think they have to score.
You know, it'd be perfect for this game for Western United is Diamante. Yeah. But unfortunately, he's not going to be ready.
Well, there are a number of absentees now for Western United. Nikolai Topor-Stanley is out. Rennie Kurhin is out for the finals.
Steve Lustig is still out.
Now, Steve Lustig could be back, I'm told. Does that make a big enough difference? He's got 5 goals this season, has scored important goals from midfield as well. But Western United, Millsy, 7 times 1-0 winners. That would be enough to take it to extra time, to just put, you know, a little bit of extra tension in there. We know they can do it. We know if they get that goal that they can hold on to a result as well.
Yeah, they can, and by no means.
I mean, this is not over.
Am I writing them off at all? But, you know, like Simon said, I can't see Victory not scoring. So I think it's going to need more than one goal for them to sit back. And, you know, Western like to have something to defend. And you saw in that first leg, they sort of went away from what they've been doing all year. In that first 20 minutes, they pressed quite high and they created a few chances. But you see they want that because they want that goal to defend. Yeah, so I said, I'm not writing them off at all because they've still got a lot of quality. This boy here scored some fantastic goals this season and had some chances on the weekend as well, midweek as well. So, look, it's going to be a fantastic game.
Simon, last word on this one. It's the two best defences in the land as well. We've spoken about Jamie Young, but there are some fantastic defenders, some fantastic organisation, and two coaches who know each other very, very well as well, who haven't enjoyed the greatest of success in finals matches so far in their careers. They'll both, John Aloisi and Tony Popovic, be desperate to get their names on that trophy as well.
Well, you know, particularly Tony Popovic, because obviously he's been to 3 grand finals previously, or is it 4?
4.
Lost 4, count. 4 isn't lost. It? Because did one with Perth as well.
Yeah, exactly.
And lost a lot. So, you know, at some point, he's such a good coach that he's got to break that. And you just see what he's done with Melbourne Victory this season. Let's not forget that, you know, they were wooden spoonists last year. They were bottom of the heap, and he's got them right up the other end, and, you know, now just 90 minutes away from another grand final. So he's done a super job. His recruitment has been spot on. Same with Western United. John Aloisi, I've said this throughout the entire season, that their foreigners that he's brought in have been top draw. Leo Lacroix in particular, Priovic, obviously Diamante was already there. Kurhin in the second half of the season. And he's supplemented that with very good Australian signings. Jamie Young has been terrific for them between the posts. Neil Kilkenny, unsung hero in midfield. They're a very, very good side. Mm. But I just think at the moment, Victory are a bit better.
Yeah, it has been a fantastic turnaround. I think Victory are looking to become the first side ever to go from wooden spoon to championship winning side.
A couple have done it the other way around, I know that.
Newcastle did it, absolutely.
Adelaide
as well, went from top dogs to... Yeah. And Brisbane went from second from bottom in 2010 to go all the way to the grand final under Ange in 2011 as well. Second semi-final to be played out. It'll be Sunday. It's an early kickoff time. It's coverage starting on 10 Bold and Paramount Plus at 1:30 in the afternoon. Kickoff at 2 p.m., so an early kickoff at Amy. Not much time for the grass to rest and recover for that one. And that will see Melbourne City taking on Adelaide. Millsy, we've just had a brief chat in looking at what's happened in the first two elimination and first leg of the semis, but what are you expecting in the second half of this one?
I think we touched on it last night after the first leg. I probably foresee Melbourne City starting that game more the way they finished the first leg. I thought the last 10 minutes, you know, they were a lot more positive. They were looking to be on the front foot. And at home, I think City, that's the way City will start. I think they'll try and get at Adelaide quite early. Mm. Adelaide, you know, have never really just sat back and tried to absorb pressure. You know, they're going to want to play as well. So, look, I think it's going to be a more open affair than the first leg. And it's just going to come down to small moments. You see, yeah. Melbourne City had a few moments early on in the first game that they didn't take. Same with Adelaide, I can't see that being the case in the second leg. I think, like I said, both teams are going to go for this.
Strangely enough, I think the games between the two this season, I've called most of them, I think, and they've sort of followed a bit of a pattern. And yet that pattern in the first leg sort of turned on its head. Mm. Normally it's City who start strongly, get an advantage, and then it's Adelaide who come back in typical fashion and you know, snatch a draw or all 3 points. I wonder if it's going to revert to type in the second leg. I agree with Millsy. I think City will come out flying. They'll try and get the goals early to put the tie to bed. But if they don't get more than a goal in front or don't get that first goal, we know how strongly Adelaide can finish. Now, they couldn't do that in the first leg because I think of the short turnaround from the game against the Mariners. But they've done it repeatedly this season, particularly with those goals off the bench. So I don't think this one is a done deal by any means. I still think City are the favourites to go through and make it an all-Melbourne final, in my opinion. But don't discount Adelaide at all.
Could we see some changes to the Adelaide lineup from what we saw in their first two finals matches, Mills, do you think?
Yeah,
you mentioned perhaps Yenge, who's been managed in his comeback.
Yeah, I think possibly we could. I think, obviously, last week, Yenge and Ibasuki... Mm-hmm. No, Ibasuki started on the bench. It was Yenge and Blackwood. And then this week with Ibasuki and Yenge coming back in is a possibility. I think Bernardo's a chance to come back in as well.
Yeah, Lockie Brook was looked a bit fatigued on the first leg.
Yeah, but it wasn't bad by any means, but I just you know, up high when they have that possession, Bernardo's just a little bit more clinical with his decision making and a little bit quicker on that. I think we might see a few changes, particularly in that front third, but... Melbourne City, I don't think so. I think Melbourne City will set up as they've been setting up, you know, for the majority of the season.
Well, we know that Aidan O'Neill is out for the finals campaign as well.
Berenguer could be back
with his hamstring. Apparently he was very close last night. Could that make a big difference in that middle of the park?
Look, it could. Who does he replace? You know,
does he start or does he just...
Well, exactly. If he starts, then probably...
He's not so much an impact player off the bench, though, is he?
I think if he starts, Marco Tilio probably has to drop out, which is unfortunate. Probably wasn't quite at his best against Adelaide in the first leg, but it's not a nice problem for Paddy. Yeah.
If he's coming back and you're planning on him playing in the grand final, then he needs to get some sort of minutes. So if he is on the bench, he might not be that kind of player, but I think you have to have him there and be prepared to give him minutes if need be.
Now, you're going to be asked this a million times in pre-game shows and all week, but of course we're going to ask the question, who do you think is going to go through this weekend, Simon Hill?
All Melbourne final for me. I think it's going to be victory against City or City against victory, whichever way you want to slice it.
I think that Adelaide-Melbourne game will be quite close, but look, I think it could be an all Melbourne final as well.
Yeah.
What about you, Robbie?
I'm thinking Melbourne versus Adelaide.
Melbourne who? Oh, sorry. Yep. Melbourne victory.
I did say that on purpose, but yeah, I guess it doesn't really work for Western, does it? I could see Adelaide getting through, just, you know, to say something different, put the cat amongst the pigeons, as you do. Okay, so there we can see it. Saturday, 4:30 p.m. The coverage starting on 10 Bold and Paramount Plus. Kickoff at 5 p.m. Melbourne victory versus Western United, and then on Sunday. Don't forget, early kickoff time, 1:30 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time, 10 Bold Paramount Plus. Melbourne City looking to go back-to-back in the finals as well against the outsiders, the challengers, the Reds from Adelaide United. Now, grand final week will be a big week, and it's going to kick off on the Wednesday preceding the grand final, because we have the A-League All-Stars who are taking on a visiting FC Barcelona side. We are assured that it is a very solid FC Barcelona that are coming. There's only for the moment Pedri, who looks like he could miss out with a hamstring injury that's kept him sidelined for the last few weeks, but he's only played 1,000 matches this season anyway, and looking forward to the break. Now, we have more or less an outline of what looks like the All-Stars squad. Of course, it all depends on what happens and who qualifies for the grand final and what happens this weekend, because those players will not be available. Question over Socceroos and possibly the Australian under-23 side as well. Will they risk themselves in the All-Stars game against FC Barcelona before going off to play, certainly for the Socceroos and the World Cup qualifiers, but also for the under-23s who have the Asian Cup coming up in Uzbekistan, which will be all sorts of fun for them as well. So, Simon, we went through our All-Stars 11 last week. Milsey, do you remember that off the top of your head? Who's in there? There are a couple. We went with Florent Berenguer, who's not even in the squad at all.
He doesn't remember
all.
When subs are coming on. Never mind what happened in last week's show.
You're asking a lot of me, mate.
We also, well, speaking of things that have slipped through the net then and gone through to the keeper, we didn't do the chat about Jenkinson's handball, but it would have only been that was handball, that wasn't handball, that was handball, so we'll leave that chat. So, on this one, Simon.
You want my team?
I want your team.
Right, okay. Now, I'm going to preface this by saying, so don't hate me, Adelaide and Western United fans, that I think it's going to be an all-Melbourne grand final. I've already said that. So I've omitted players from both City and Victory in my starting 11 on the assumption that they are going to be in the grand final. So just a reminder that that's not necessarily the case as we sit here today. So I've gone for Jamie Young in goal. I've gone for a back four of Ryan Grant of Sydney FC, Leo Lacroix, Western United, Adrian Mariappa from MacArthur, and Adama Traore from Western Sydney Wanderers. That's my defence.
So from my memory from last weekend, that differs. We had Birigitti in goal in ours. Guerrier and Davidson, I think, were the two fullbacks.
Yep.
And we had Curtis Good in the middle as
well.
So only
completely different.
One. Leo Lacroix has withstood the Simon Hill test.
Okay. Midfield three.
Culling.
I've gone for Daniel Pena. I don't know who's tracking back in out of these three, by the way. So I've gone for Daniel Pena, Jay O'Shea, and Anthony Caceres.
Well, it could be poor old Jay O'Shea that has to do the number
six. All nice
ball
playing midfielders, but yeah, not a lot of energy in there. I did think about Isaias in that role, but you know, it's a theoretical. So, and my front three, this is the three that really excite me. So I've gone for, on the left, Craig Goodwin.
Yeah.
The number nine, Jason Cummings, presuming he's not going to be, you know, involved in Socceroos stuff. And on the right, my little wild card of Garang Kuol.
Yeah, very good. Who didn't he look good even when he came on? That's just composed footballer at 17 years of age in that Mariners side. Very nice. Milsey, I can't remember our midfielders. Can you?
No, I can't.
We had
a
number six. So in that respect, we're probably a little more disciplined than
positions covered.
Yeah.
Jay can sit in that six. He'll be all
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I think so.
You
I
can do
so.
It, Jay.
But we didn't have this list last week.
No, exactly. We didn't have the list as well. So no one went with Pena in this in our 11s as well. Oh, you did.
I did
have Pena. Sorry. Yeah. Yeah, it's one of the ones that aren't tracking back. I was, sorry.
Jay
O'Shea, Anthony Caceres, and Pena.
Yeah.
Very good. All right. Just very quickly before we move on from this, the coach of the A-League All-Stars is also the coach of the MacArthur Bulls. Simon, what a surprise that was to hear that on come out on the weekend.
It was a bit. Although, you know, obviously Dwight York's name has been sort of touted around for the last few weeks. Obviously sniffing to try and get his first senior coaching gig. He's got his badges. Look, we know what a great player Dwight was. We know that he knows Australia and knows the competition because he played here for Sydney FC in the early days of the competition. The great unknown is whether he can coach. And there is an argument to be said for a local coach getting a go, particularly as we only have, you know, 12 senior coaching gigs in the A-League. And I think that's a very good point that a lot of people have made. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's a privately owned club. MacArthur can do what they want. It's their money. If they want Dwight York, they're perfectly entitled to go and get him. And I wish him all the very best. I hope he's a success. He's a great fella. He'll probably get a few headlines as well, you know, maybe off the pitch. I don't know whether he's quieting down a bit, but, you know, he's a big name. I hope he can coach, and I hope he does well.
Final word on this All-Stars chat, and I'll throw one more to Millsy. FC Barcelona, to play against them for these players, it's a fantastic opportunity for them as well. I've heard it said Barcelona didn't have a great year. They still finished second in La Liga ahead of Atletico Madrid. They only lost six matches all season. Champions League, they've struggled to reach semi-finals for the last few years, so that's not really that different. I think this is still a very good Barcelona that are not the Barcelona they were perhaps of 5-10 years ago, but still taking on FC Barcelona. They remain one of the biggest clubs in the world, and it's a fantastic experience.
Yeah, absolutely. It's an enormous experience for whoever gets to step on the field and play them. You get to play one of the best, I still believe, one of the best teams in the world. Mm. What they had to deal with early on in the season and where they were to where they finished, you know, still shows what a powerhouse that they are. It's going to be in front of a massive crowd, massive TV audience. It's going to be a great experience for all the boys that are involved.
Of course, it was Xavi who came back, and one of their own who came back and turned that ship around. Speaking of fantastic clubs, women's football, Olympique Lyonnais and FC Barcelona as well are two fantastic football clubs. Barcelona, the reigning European champions, and Olympique Lyonnais, who have won the Champions League 7 times, 5 times in a row between 2016 and 2020, and they have an Australian right back, Ellie Carpenter, who I was lucky enough to speak to. She is looking to become the first Australian to win a European trophy since...
Aidan Hrustic.
This morning, Aidan Hrustic did it. Fantastic result there for him and Eintracht Frankfurt as well. But the first Champions League winner since Harry Kewell did it on that incredible night in Istanbul with Liverpool. So I chatted with Ellie Carpenter. You can find that entire chat on the 10 Play platform on the page for Round Ball Rules. But here's a little excerpt. Have a little listen to this. We're hearing that there's going to be a mini tournament played back in Australia. So the Matildas will be back on home soil early next year in sort of February, a little mini international tournament. How are preparations going with Tony Gustavsson? We've seen progression, particularly in the last couple of weeks. And how is it going with him, and how are you feeling moving towards everything?
Yeah, I think we had, you know, a year or so to experiment and to get depth and to get more players into the squad. Obviously, we had a great Olympic tournament. Then off the back of that, we've done some experimenting. And then I think, you know, post-Asian Cup is where now we're really focusing on preparation. And obviously, we started off with the New Zealand games, and we're just focusing on winning games and playing good football.
So that full interview, catch it on 10 Play on the Round Ball Rules page. Of course, as Mark Milligan just reminded me, officially Ellie did win the Champions League 2 years ago, but it was during that campaign that was stopped for COVID and then played after the start of the next season, where she signed for Olympique Lyonnais.
And she sat on the bench in the final.
Exactly. Yeah. She didn't play in the final. So in theory, we're both right, Mercy. Isn't that good? What That's a perfect, perfect way to bring the curtain down on the show where everyone is always right. Round Ball Rules. Good stuff. Next week, we'll be back on Wednesday before the grand final. It will be our final episode of the season, but we hope you've enjoyed Round Ball Rules. Gentlemen, it's been a pleasure,
good to see
as
you,
always.
Robbie.
And we'll see you again next week. Bye for now.